sometimes Fourier transforms become really nice. You can think, for example, of a derivative or a convolution. In this video, we'll encounter two functions with nice Fourier transforms. The delta function and its approximation phi epsilon of x. The Fourier transform of the second one will give us a lemma that we will need to derive the formula for the inverse Fourier transform later on. So let us take a look. Let's start with the delta function. So what was the delta function? Well, the delta function is a function such that if you integrate some f of x from minus infinity to infinity, the delta function picks out exactly the value of f of x at x naught. So that yields f of x naught. So what happens if you try to compute the Fourier transform of a delta function? So what do you need to do if you want to compute a Fourier transform? You take your function, you add the factor e to the power minus I omega x, and you integrate with respect to x from minus infinity to infinity. So what do we get if you do that? Well, that's easy. If you have a delta function in, the delta function picks out exactly the value where x minus x not equals zero. So you have x equals x naught, so you plug it in over here, and you get the e to the power minus I omega x naught. So that's the Fourier transform of the delta function. That one is really nice. And for example, if you have x naught equals 1, then you get here e to the power 0, and the Fourier transform of the delta function delta x with x naught equals 0 is just a function 1. So Fourier transform of delta function becomes 1. Now, what happens if we now look at the approximation of a delta function of our phi epsilon of x? So first, we take a look at phi of x. So what was phi of x again? It was our Gaussian, our normalized Gaussian. So phi of x equals e to the power minus 1/2 x squared, and then you normalize with the 1 over square root of 2 pi. Now, earlier, we saw how to compute the Fourier transform of a Gaussian. The Fourier transform of e to the power minus ax squared yields another Gaussian, e to the power minus omega squared over 4a. And then you get an additional factor of square root of pi over a. So what will be the Fourier transform of this particular Gaussian over here? Well, in this case, we have a prefactor 1 over the square root of 2 pi. And for our a, we have 1/2. So if you plug that in into our formula, we plug in a equals 1/2. In our exponent, we get omega squared divided by 4a. 4 times 1/2 equals 2. So you get e to the power minus omega squared over 2. And what about our prefactor? Well, the prefactor over here becomes square root of pi over 1/2. So that yields square root of 2 pi. But we are also dividing by the square root of 2 pi, so those cancel out, so the prefactor becomes 1. So the Fourier transform of phi becomes e to the power minus omega squared over 2. And you see that's almost the same as our original function phi of x, because if we plug in x equals omega in phi of x, we get phi of omega, we get e to the power minus 1/2 omega squared, and we divided by square root of 2 pi. So if we multiply this phi of omega by square root of 2 pi, we get exactly e to the power minus omega squared over 2. So what do we see? Our phi hat of omega equals, well, apart from a square root of 2 pi, our phi of omega. Now what happens if you take a look at phi hat of omega, the phi hat epsilon of omega? You know the definition of phi epsilon of omega. That was phi of x over epsilon is an additional 1 over epsilon. So what do we get if we compute the Fourier transform of that? Well, you know how to compute the Fourier transform of a function u of b of x. What do you need to do? Then you got the Fourier transform of 1 over b times phi of the u of omega over b. So what do you get? You take the 1 over epsilon out and invert it. And that's going to cancel out this 1 over epsilon. And you get your Fourier transform in the omega over 1 over epsilon. So that becomes a phi hat of epsilon times omega. And you can convert that, as you know, to a phi of omega. And you just have to add a factor square root of 2 pi. So there we are. So now you also know the Fourier transform of phi epsilon of x. And you can plug in the numbers, of course. The phi hat epsilon of omega becomes this expression over here. So plug in epsilon omega over here and multiply by 2 pi, which cancels out this factor over there. So you get minus 1/2 epsilon squared omega squared. And if you take epsilon to 0, you get limit epsilon to 0 phi hat epsilon of omega equals 1. And that makes sense, because if you take epsilon to 0, your phi epsilon of omega tends to the delta function. So if you take epsilon to 0, the Fourier transform of your phi epsilon of omega tends to the Fourier transform of the delta function to 1. So now you know the Fourier transform of the delta function, you know the Fourier transform of phi of x, you know the Fourier transform of phi epsilon of x. Finally, we use this for a lemma which we will need later on to prove the formula for the inversion of the Fourier transform. We want to prove the following lemma: phi epsilon of x equals this strange integral over here. Now, how do we do that? First, we use the definition of phi epsilon of x equals 1 over epsilon times phi of x over epsilon. Then we can convert this phi of something into its Fourier transform by the formula over here. The phi of omega equals 1 over square root of 2 pi phi hat of omega. So we get the 1 over square root of 2 pi. We keep the 1 over epsilon in front over here. And on the spot of omega, we substitute x over epsilon. So phi epsilon of x is also equal to some constant times its Fourier transform with x of epsilon. Now we use the definition of Fourier transform. We just leave this constant where it is. So what's the phi hat of something? Well, that's the phi of xi d xi. So integrate phi with respect to xi. And now, instead of omega, we have an x over epsilon. So normally there's an omega over here. Now we have an x over epsilon instead. And we have the xi because we integrate with respect to xi. And then you see we're already quite close to the formula over here. We just need a few substitutions to prove our lemma. First of all, we set xi over epsilon to y. So we get an y over here, an epsilon y over here. And d xi over epsilon together forms a dy as well. Then we set z equal to minus y. Now our function, so this in this so over here we get an e to the power of plus ixz. A minus sign goes in over here. The dz becomes minus dy, but we also need to change the order of the boundary, so those minus signs cancel out. And finally, we use that our Gaussians are symmetric, so phi of minus something equals phi of something, so you can sketch out the minus sign. And then you have the formula over here, which is exactly this formula over here. So that gives us our lemma, and we will need this expression for phi epsilon of x later on to prove this Fourier inversion formula.